a call following Lenin, with whom Žižek, I might venture to ask, has a psychoanalytically interesting relationship, to learn, learn, and learn. In conversation yesterday, Slavoj Žižek elaborated on ideology in the post-ideological world, the case of Hollywood. This is particularly pertinent to us at Sarai, because the entire field of cultural communication... Please turn off your cell phones.
Your cell phones. Oh, no, this here, I dedicated one of my last books to my good friend Alain Badiou, who did something which I think is, maybe you know the story, a sign of absolute friendship. Only the one who really hates you or really loves you can do this. It was, I gave a talk, but you were sitting in the first row, a little bit less people than here, and but you asked me, he told me he expects an important phone call to lend him my cell phone. I did it, and in the middle of my talk, the phone rang, he of course started talking, and then, because I talked, the people, he didn't hear me well, so he told me, could I speak a little bit lower so that he can talk? This is friend. You can do something like this only to an absolute friend. And I think we are coming close to this kind of friends, because now I will, on purpose, ironically, read you in an evil way. Thank you for the introduction, where the people basically learned that I was born in 49, that is that I'm 6 years old, that I was a candidate by laws, that I'm a failed politician, and that I, all this electricity dynamic, that I'm a totally confused soul. 60 years old, failed politician. I noticed another wonderful thing by you, I thought you would say, you were thanking all of them, did I hear it correctly? But when you enumerated people you are thanking, you included yourself. This is what I call Hegelian self-reflection. So, this is my ideal. Why shouldn't the organizer thank himself? I think I would do it. Yeah. And for a brief moment, I thought we are entering Marx Brothers era, where you know, you introduce him, he introduced you. My idea was, why don't you go on and... Just one reminder, all this Lacan filler, no, my true love is philosophy. I'm now returning to it, I'm now writing a book, I already have 700 pages, it will be madness, on Hegel, what comes before, after. I will start with Hegel Buddhism, Hegel Plato, and so on and so on. That's where my love is. I'm ready to sell everything. Marx, Freud, Lacan for Hegel. That's another story. I really cannot emphasize how grateful I am to be here, not only for obvious personal reasons, not only for reasons of analyzing or getting at least an insight into what goes in this big, beautiful, and more, at least some good news in the world, important country. I was really shocked. This was totally new to me, by the loss of Manu, the book, and on the other hand, on the other side, Ambedkar, now, who is pretty much uncovered, as you said, unknown in Europe. But I will talk more tomorrow about it, about how I think he was totally right against Gandhi, in how he, what Gandhi didn't see or didn't want to see, Ambedkar put it very nicely, where he says, no, there are no castes without outcasts, as they put it, no? You cannot solve the problem of untouchables by giving them their proper place, yo, you are the children of God, recognizing them, and so on, no? It doesn't work like that. But more about this tomorrow. I would say that the reason the loss of Manu fascinated me so much, it's really like a detective story, I couldn't stop reading it. It's not, this is one aspect that you already emphasized, this. Where is ideology in what you are doing? I will try to return to it later. Here I'm a little bit critical of the Marx you quoted, this, you know, the difference between what you are doing and what you are thinking. But for me, the problem is that the illusion is, as you said, in what the illusion is in what you are doing. For example, take a kind of a Brahmin liberal here, no? He probably would say, no, I respect untouchables, blah, blah, blah. But then the way he walks, he eats, who cleans his sheet, and so on. There, the illusions are, ideology is in what he does. That's one aspect. More about this tomorrow. I want now to start with another thing, why feature which absolutely fascinated me, and I loved it in Manu, the book, this, the way it relates the rule, the big law, prohibition, and exception. If I may isolate what I perceived as whenever it deals with some big rule, law, prohibition, this is almost a model I discovered. First, it states a prohibition. Then it implicitly accepts that we all violate this prohibition. And then it regulates exceptions, violations. Like, just now I remembered it. Like, it says, Veda priests should study Veda, not trade. Okay, obviously they were all trading. Because then they say, you can trade, but only certain things. For example, you shouldn't trade, sell, buy sesame seeds. Then it says, you can do it, but if you do it, at least do it on the right day, not on Sunday, and so on and so on. No? It goes almost endlessly. Only at the very end, when practically all versions are exhausted, it finally says, but if you do, in spite of all this, then you will be reborn as a worm in a dog sheet or whatever. This but I like this idea. How, and this is a profound lesson that I will first start to elaborate. The great illustration of this wisdom of the loss of Manu will be, not now in 3 minutes, will be Casablanca, the film. I will try to show why. How, again, laws, our systems of prohibitions and so on, do not so much regulate. It's not just what is prohibited, what is not prohibited. They accept that we violate prohibition. The point is to regulate violations. This is where the law really holds you. And how does this bring us to Hollywood? I would like to, now you are warned 2 minutes. I would like to show you from a film which for many people, more even than Gone with the Wind or whatever, stands for Hollywood, as it were, at its zero level, Casablanca. And it's an honest Hollywood left liberal film. The proof of its relative honesty is that a couple of years later, in the McCarthy era of witch hunt, practically all of them were blacklisted, and so on. So
lights.
Uh-huh. No, just a little bit more. That I describe. This is the scene. You don't have to know anything, but just give you a vague idea. About 2/3 into the film, the lady played by Ingrid Bergman comes to. This is not her husband. This is her ex-love, Humphrey Bogart, Rick, to his room, and asks him for some visa letter for her and her husband and so on and so on. They have a conversation which gets more and more passionate. Then they embrace and then, please, watch carefully, it's just 1 minute. And try to give some sound, although it's not. No, this is too much, this is modern art. Okay, yes, here. And I'll try to get some sound. It's not crucial. Maybe you should do it. But it works also, basically it works without sound. What you remember is that they talk.